geospatial analysis laboratory, where he focuses on the application of geospatial technologies to natural resources and conservation-related projects. He has used geographic information systems, GIS, and remote sensing applications in wildlife habitat mapping, biodiversity assessment, ecological reserve design, conservation lands, and forest characterization. His current work focuses on the use of LIDAR and multispectral data in tree canopy mapping and other land cover projects.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Can everyone hear me okay? So this afternoon I'd like to talk about some remote sensing technologies that we believe are increasingly becoming more prevalent in the state and should become more prevalent in the state. And we believe that these applications, these technologies, have important implications for research here and elsewhere in the region. Very quickly, just to give a shout to some of our funding sources, most notably MoMA, the U.S. Department of Transportation. So the first technology I'd like to discuss this afternoon is LIDAR. So LIDAR is not a new technology. In fact, it's been used for a decade or more in a variety of applications. But until recently, there was relatively few good quality LIDAR data sets available for Vermont. But fortunately, that is changing. So I'll just give a little bit of background for context then. LIDAR, light detection and ranging. The key thing to remember about LIDAR is that it's an active sensor technology. So the sensor actually emits a beam of light, a pulse of light toward the ground. That pulse is reflected off of objects on the ground, and some of those reflectances are ultimately recorded by the sensor. This is in contrast to a passive sensor technology where solar radiation is reflected off the Earth's surface. So this active sensor technology provides a lot more information because the timing and the duration of those pulses are known. It is possible to estimate the height of features above ground. Another important distinction with LIDAR is that depending on its specifications, you can also have partial penetration of certain objects on the ground, such as a tree. Some of the LIDAR beams will actually penetrate the canopy, and some of them will even reach the ground. So what this means in a practical sense, then, is for each LIDAR return, whether it's representing a building, the top of a building, the ground, or the top of a tree, or some feature underneath the tree, we have basically a three-dimensional fix for that point. So that's a tremendous amount of information that is not available for passive sensor technologies. So this, of course, is not Vermont, but this is New York City, but it shows one of the essentially what we require data. The basic product is a point cloud, and that point cloud has texture and depth that can be filtered to yield information. Here's just a few close-ups then that show the tremendous detail that certain data sets can provide. One last technical consideration that I'll mention is that the LIDAR that I'm describing here is the so-called discrete return LIDAR. That's in contrast to this other type of LIDAR, waveform LIDAR, that you may have seen references to. It's quite commonly used in forestry applications. But in Vermont, virtually all, as far as I know, if not all of the data that's being collected is this discrete return type. So something to keep in mind. So both types of LIDAR have been used in a variety of applications elsewhere in the country and the world. For instance, cover type mapping, also used for forest structure and biomass estimation, similarly with growing stock estimation. Because we can quantify forests with LIDAR, then of course there are applications for the things that depend on forests, such as wildlife. And of course, in the era of global climate change, estimation of carbon stocks is also very important and is possible with LIDAR. A little closer to home, here in at UVM, the Spatial Analysis Lab, we have used LIDAR quite extensively for tree canopy delineation. Because we have LIDAR, we've been able to map tree canopy basically to the scale of individual trees for a large number of urban and suburban settings. An ancillary benefit of that high quality data has also been the ability to conduct localities that are affected by pests and storm damage and land use change. We're also interested in contiguously forested areas. So once again, if we take a look at a LIDAR point cloud, you can see just even with a visual analysis, there's a lot of information inherent in that. If we look at, of course, a broad landscape area, we can start filtering that information, that LIDAR, to provide information not only on canopy, but features underneath that canopy, including understory vegetation. So to give you an example of one project that we've been working on, Al Strong here at the University of Vermont and Paul Schauberg at the U.S. Forest Service have been conducting a project in Hubbard Brook Experimental Forest in New Hampshire. The object of this study has been to assess the utility of LIDAR in predicting the characteristics of forest, important characteristics of forest, and then ultimately their relevance to, or the ability to predict wildlife habitat and forest health indices. So our part of this project has been to demonstrate some of the capabilities of LIDAR. So for instance, if we're interested in canopy gaps, we can look at a normalized digital surface model from LIDAR, and we can map those. And similarly, if we're looking at understory vegetation, in this case, we're looking at that first 10 meters or so of vegetation, we can also quite effectively map that. So this work is ongoing, but we're optimistic that it will indeed demonstrate the utility of LIDAR. Another project that we have just started involves the delineation or the estimation of areas that might support vernal pools. The Vermont Center for Eco Studies is constructing this great statewide atlas of vernal pools. In fact, Steve Fascio is here today, gave a presentation, I think, in the last session. But we, in our discussions with them, we wondered whether LIDAR could be used to help facilitate the identification of potential areas. So for instance, if we take a known location, right, a known vernal pool, we can take a look at the LIDAR available for it, and indeed that profile shows a cavity, and the task then will be to reliably predict these areas across the landscape. So that's LIDAR, and as of this point, or actually I should say mid next year, we'll have about a third of the state covered with good quality LIDAR. And the goal, the expectation of many in the state, is that we'll ultimately have full coverage, ultimately. So that's the goal, and we'll provide quite a number of important research applications for studying Vermont landscapes. So very quickly, I'd also like to describe another technology that we're starting to use in the state, and this is the use of unmanned aerial vehicles for capturing basically color orthophotography. So we have now with the Spatial Analysis Lab, in conjunction with the Transportation Research Center, we have a UAV, and we can collect orthophotography, basically imagery that is GIS ready. It's geo-referenced and also ortho-rectified. It's also possible to develop 3D representations from this imagery. The real key to it, however, is its near real-time acquisition of information. So just to give you an indication of what this is like, this is the model that we have. It's called an EV. It's a rather unimposing looking thing. The real technological marvel of this UAV is actually the software that's used to plan flights to operate the UAV, and then also to post-process the data. The actual use of the UAV is almost pathetically easy, believe it or not. Here's Jarlath O'Neill Dunn showing perfect form and releasing the UAV. And here it is in flight. By FAA regulations, we cannot fly above 400 feet. Some people have thought that the UAV looks like a drunken raven in flight. I think it was more of a geriatric turkey vulture. But at any rate, with the software, we can follow it. Almost out of time here, but the UAV is very, very easy to operate, and it essentially lands itself. So once we have collected data, we go back to the lab, and in a mere 2 or 3 hours worth of time, we can develop scenes like this. So this is a color ortho photograph for a part of Chittenden County. And if we take a closer look at it, you can see some of the details that are evident that basically we can identify trees to the species level. We also, again, can produce 3D representations. So we feel that this is an important technology for studying landscapes. Obviously, we can't cover the entire state with something like a UAV, but it could be very important for site-specific time series analysis of certain features, so for instance, forest types, wetlands, streams that may change over time and quickly, and we believe that that has important implications for monitoring natural resources. So I believe I'm out of time, but thank you very much, and I'd be happy to take any questions.
Challenge.